Good. Hello, everybody. My name is Yvette Welling. I'm a postdoc working at DAISY. And in this short talk, I will present a paper we recently posted to the archive with the title Harmonic Hybrid Inflation. And it's based on work in collaboration with Federico Carta, Nicole Ricci, and Alexander Westphal. Okay, yes. So let me first start by introducing the original model of hybrid inflation introduced by Linde. And it was proposed as a hybrid between old false vacuum inflation and new slow roll inflation. And the typical prototype model is depicted in the formula over here, where you can see that the phi field, as long as it's displaced from zero, actually generates a mass for the chi field. And as long as if it's bigger than some critical value, phi critical, then the mass of the chi field is very heavy and it will be stabilized at zero. So that's in corresponding in the figure here, somewhere in this region. And at the same time, it's stabilized at zero, but its potential energy is non-zero, so it will generate a large vacuum, false vacuum energy for the phi field, effectively. And therefore, it can easily accommodate slow roll inflation, where the field phi only traverses a sub-Planckian field excursions during the last 60 evals of inflation. And as inflation proceeds, at some point, phi will cross the critical point where the chi field then suddenly becomes tachyonic or its perturbations. And the chi perturbations will then grow exponentially. And inflation will end almost instantaneously. And at the same time, preheating will basically end in a couple of evals, tachyonic preheating. But it can also be estimated because now there's this vacuum degeneracy, those two vacua are both at zero, and there's a C2 symmetry in with respect to the inflationary trajectory. It can be shown that the typical size of the domains with the two vacuum solutions are much smaller than the size of the horizon, and in between there will be this massive energy density called domain walls, and they will actually start to dominate the energy budget of the universe, and this constitutes the so-called domain wall problem. So that's one issue, and another big issue is the usual eta problem. So if we consider this model of inflation as an effective description, then if there's, in the absence of any protection mechanism, the radiative corrections will actually drive the masses of the chi and the phi fields to the cutoff scale. And it will spoil the necessary required hierarchy between the two masses in order to have the hybrid setup. And moreover, as also recently analyzed in this paper referred to here, it turns out that where they actually studied a generalization of this potential with some with all the relevant and marginal operators, and it turns out that in order to have a model of hybrid inflation compatible with the data, it's actually not that you actually need not that small field excursions, but more delta phi of order just below M Planck field range. And therefore, we know that not only dimension six operators, but a whole series of high dimensional Planck suppressed operators will be relevant for making the predictions. For making the prediction, but also they have to be sufficiently small in order not to spoil slow roll inflation. So therefore, we are motivated to consider a model of hybrid inflation that's driven by two axioms. where we have knowledge of all the higher dimensional operators, and we guess, or we can propose a model of the hypertype of this form, where you can see now that if the phi 2 field is such that the cosine is -1 or negative, then the field phi 1 will be stabilized at a point where this cosine is equal to -1. So this phi 1 field plays the same role as the chi field in the previous slide. And the phi 2 field will play the role of the inflaton. And as long as this cosine remains negative, this field remains stabilized, but at some point it crosses a critical value where the phi 1 field becomes tachyonic, just as in hybrid inflation, and then inflation will end. And considering the things I said in the previous slide, because we require smallest field excursions for the last 60 evils of inflation, this would correspond to sub-Planckian decay constant, which is nice. And I have to say that similar type of structures for this potential have been considered in other papers, where I here list an incomplete subset of them, where actually sub-Planckian decay constants have been employed to generate an effectively large field model of inflation. It's just with in a different part of parameter space, let's say, all these coefficients and amplitudes. And since we actually need to know the not only the relevant operators in expanding the cosines, but also the higher order corrections, the harmonic structure is really crucial for the predictions, and therefore this motivated us to name this model harmonic hybrid inflation. And some of the nice features of this model is that in this this particular setup, it generically produces a red tilt. This is as opposed to this simple original hybrid model I showed in the previous slide, which generically actually predicts a blue tilt. And moreover, you can find the boundaries of the field space where we have at least 60 evils of inflation. So everything within this blue patch will generate sufficient inflation, and it's quite a sizable region in the compared to the, let's say, the fundamental domain of this potential. So there's not much fine-tuning of the homogeneous initial conditions, which is also nice. However, we still have this problem of the formation of domain walls, because there's this exact C2 symmetry in the phi 1 direction with respect to the inflationary trajectory. And in order to avoid this problem, we have to break this C2 symmetry. And if we now expand the potential in a more canonical form, so instead of multiplying cosines, we just write it as a sum of cosines. The simplest way we can actually break this symmetry is by slightly shifting those C1 coefficients, one with 1 plus delta, the other one with 1 minus delta. This should be a minus, sorry, that's a typo. Such that the potential, the vacuum degeneracy is removed, because one vacuum will be lifted with respect to the other. But at the same time, the potential also gets twisted, in the sense that, it's maybe not super clear from this illustration, but one thing you can see is this black dot is the represents the saddle point of the in the potential, from where inflation should start in the neighborhood. If we compare it to the previous potential, it's shifted substantially. But here we only take delta of order to be equal to 0.02. And moreover, because of this twisting, we actually, if you inflate, the phi 1 field will still be stabilized. But at some point, if you end the region where it's stabilized, actually the trajectory that doesn't end up exactly on this hilltop, but it rather would roll towards one of the minima because the symmetry is broken. So this actually avoids the generation of domain walls altogether. And another difference with respect to the previous setup is that even with this small breaking of the C2 symmetry, the range of initial conditions, so the blue patch again, will be still sizable, but it will be mainly on one side of the saddle point. So on one side of the saddle point, we have lots of freedom to choose our initial conditions, but on the other side, it will be super narrow. So the and those most natural initial conditions, they will always end up in a vacuum that's not the global minimum. So the here in this picture, the global minimum is located here. And it's actually, in that sense, repulsive. But for a small symmetry breaking, the vacuum degeneracy is also not that big. So let me now show you the predictions for this model where we broke the C2 symmetry by showing you the predictions in an NSR plane. Where so all the predictions are in this purple contour, and it's compared to the Planck constraints with the one sigma, one and two sigma evidence contours, the green and the gray contours. And in order to illustrate these predictions, since it's convenient to introduce two parameters, namely alpha, which is the denotes the relative size of the amplitudes of the cosines, and this one needs to be much less than one in order to have a hybrid-like setting in the sense that the phi 2 field has a large false vacuum energy in order to that generates a small field excursion, and another parameter gamma. It's alpha times C2 squared. This turns out to be a useful variable such that if we now actually change the value of alpha, this whole contour will just move up and down if we keep the value of gamma fixed. So there are kind of degenerate, the two variables that actually determine mostly the predictions, and of course also the value of delta. And so in this purple contour, if we move from left to right, it's we vary the value of gamma. If we change the value of delta, we go along these dashed lines in the contours. And one can see that the predictions are actually very sensitive to the exact model parameters. If we vary gamma only in this small range, already the predictions for NS span a very wide range. And also here we vary delta, let's say between minus 0.03 and plus 0.03. And already the predictions change a lot. So this is also in agreement with the ETA problem or the model sensitivity to the higher dimensional operators, which I described before. However, if we just would zoom in on the NS values that are still consistent with the Planck data, actually it seems that the bound for the tensor scalar ratio is bounded. One, because, okay, we can still change alpha, which will move this whole contour up and down. However, if we increase the value of alpha and we still would like to keep C bigger than 1 in order to have sub-Planckian decay constants, actually this contour will shrink. It will move up, but it will you basically kill this whole right part of the contour, and at some point you don't find any prediction compatible with the data. And if we fine-tune alpha much more than this. It means we have to fine-tune the amplitudes to be very close to each other. So in this, let's say, least fine-tuned setup, it seems that the prediction for the tensor scalar ratio is actually testable in the near future with upcoming CMB polarization experiments. But I should, of course, point out that in order to make this prediction more robust, one has to follow this up with a more dedicated study by varying all possible model parameters, including, for instance, the variation of these amplitudes with respect to each other and shifting the value of the C2s, so allowing them to take different values. Okay, so before I get to the conclusion slide, let me just point out a couple of fun facts. One is that in order to find the critical points of this potential, at least or a subset of them, also for the more more general model where all these C1 and C2 coefficients are actually not equal to each other, you can look for points where the cosines become -1, 1, or 0. And some of them will actually, they will all correspond to critical points. And the condition for them to be of this kind is given by these equations. And if you combine them, you will actually get a constraint equation imposed on the values of n1, n2, and n3, which is an of the Diophantine equation type. And you can then use elementary number theory to solve for these points. So that's we like that. It was we could say it's the first model of inflation where we actually use number theory. And another fun observation is that you can also try to estimate the patch around the shadow point. The patch in field space, the size of it, where eternal inflation is allowed, so that the quantum diffusion is much more relevant than the spiral motion. And for the case where the C2 symmetry is still present, this region is it's quite large compared to the typical size of the quantum jumps. But then if we start breaking the C2 symmetry and only for already for delta of order 0.01, we find that this region shrinks enormously. And it might in the end become so small that there will be no, it might be possible that no eternal inflation at all is allowed in this model. So depending on how you think about eternal inflation, this could be positive or negative news. And finally, we found in a paper by those people where actually they studied also a two-field model, a model of hybrid inflation, and it turned out that they would find two-field oscillons, which are much more long-lived than the one-field cosines of oscillons. And it would be very interesting to see if those oscillons could also be present in our model at the end after inflation, whether they would be produced. So that would be also a quite exciting possibility. Good. So here I show you the funding slides, and let me just end with the conclusion slides. And thank you very much.